Part the First of Lois the Witch by Elizabeth Gaskell. From All the Year Round, a weekly journal conducted by Charles Dickens, with which is incorporated Household Words. Saturday, October the 8th, 1859. Volume 1, Number 24. In the year 1691, Lois Barclay stood on a little wooden pier, steadying herself on the stable land in much the same manner as, 8 or 9 weeks ago, she had tried to steady herself on the deck of the rocking ship which had carried her across from old to New England. It seemed as strange now to be on solid earth as it had been not long ago, to be rocked by the sea, both day and by night, and the aspect of the land was equally strange. The forests which showed in the distance all round, and which in truth were not very far from the wooden houses forming the town of Boston, were of different shades of green, and different, too, in shape of outline to those which Lois Barclay knew well in her old home in Warwickshire. Her heart sank a little as she stood alone, waiting for the captain of the good ship Redemption, the kind, rough old sailor who was her only known friend in this unknown continent. Captain Holderness was busy, however, as she saw, and it would probably be some time before he would be ready to attend to her. So Lois sat down on one of the casks that lay about, and wrapped her grey duffel cloak tight about her, and sheltered herself under her hood, as well as might be from the piercing wind, which seemed to follow those whom it had tyrannised over at sea, with a dogged wish of still tormenting them on land. Very patiently did Lois sit there, although she was weary and shivering with cold, for the day was severe for May, and the Redemption, with store of necessaries and comforts for the Puritan colonists of New England, was the earliest ship that had ventured across the seas. How could Lois help thinking of the past and speculating on the future as she sat on Boston Pier at this breathing time of her life? In the dim sea mist which she gazed upon with aching eyes, filled against her will with tears from time to time, there rose the little village church of Barford, not 3 miles from Warwick, you may see it yet, where her father had preached ever since 1661, long before she was born. Her father and mother both lay dead in Barford churchyard, and the old low grey church could hardly come before her vision without her seeing the old parsonage too, the cottage covered with Austrian roses and yellow jessamine, where she had been born, sole child of parents, already long past the prime of youth. She saw the path not 100 yards long from the parsonage to the vestry door, that path which her father trod daily. For the vestry was his study, and the sanctum, where he studied the ponderous tomes of the fathers, and compared their precepts with those of the authorities of the Anglican Church of that day, the day of the later Stuarts. For Barford Parsonage at that time scarcely exceeded in size and dignity the cottages by which it was surrounded. It only contained 3 rooms on a floor, and was only 2 stories high. On the first, or ground floor, with a parlour, kitchen and back, or working kitchen. Upstairs, Mr. and Mrs. Barclay's room, that belonging to Lois, and the maidservant's room. If a guest came, Lois left her own chamber and shared old Clemence's bed. But those days were over. Never more should Lois see father or mother on earth. They slept, calm and still, in Barford churchyard, careless of what became of their orphan child, as far as earthly manifestations of care or love went. And Clemence lay there too, bound down in her grassy grave by withers of the briar rose which Lois had trained over those 3 precious graves before leaving England for ever. There were some who would fain have kept her there, one who swore in his heart a great oath unto the Lord that he would seek her sooner or later if she was still upon the earth. But he was the rich heir and only son of the miller Lucy, whose mill stood by the Avonside in the grassy Barford meadows. And his father looked higher for him than the penniless daughter of Parson Barclay, so low were parsons esteemed in those days, and the very suspicion of Hugh Lucy's attachment to Lois Barclay made his parents think it more prudent not to offer the orphan a home, although none other of the parishioners had the means, even if they had the will, to do so. So Lois swallowed her tears down till the time came for crying, and acted upon her mother's words.
"Lois, thy father is dead of this terrible fever, and I am dying. Nay, it is so, though I am easier from pain for these few hours, the Lord be praised. The cruel men of the Commonwealth have left thee very friendless. Thy father's only brother was shot down at Edge Hill. I too have a brother, though thou hast never heard me speak of him, for he was a schismatic, and thy father and he had words, and he left for that new country beyond the seas, without ever saying farewell to us. But Ralph was a kind lad till he took up these new-fangled notions, and for the old days' sake he will take thee in, and love thee as a child, and place thee among his children. Blood is thicker than water. Write to him as soon as I am gone, for, Lois, I am going, and I bless the Lord that has let me join my husband again so soon."
Such was the selfishness of conjugal love. She thought little of Lois's desolation in comparison with her rejoicing over her speedy reunion with her dead husband.
"Write to thine uncle, Ralph Hickson, Salem, New England. Put it down, child, on thy tablets, and say that I, Henrietta Barclay, charge him for the sake of all he holds dear in heaven or earth, for his salvation's sake, as well as for the sake of the old home at Leicesterbridge, for the sake of the father and mother that gave us birth, as well as for the sake of the six little children who lie dead between him and me, that he take thee into his home as if thou wert his own flesh and blood, as indeed thou art. He has a wife and children of his own, and no one need fear having thee, my Lois, my darling, my baby, among his household. Oh, Lois, would that thou wert dying with me! The thought of thee makes death sore."
Lois comforted her mother more than herself, poor child, by promises to obey her dying wishes to the letter, and by expressing hopes she dared not feel of her uncle's kindness.
"Promise me,"
the dying woman's breath came harder and harder,
"that thou wilt go at once. The money our goods will bring, the letter thy father wrote to Captain Holderness, his old schoolfellow. Thou knowest all I would say. My Lois, God bless thee."
Solemnly did Lois promise. Strictly she kept her word. It was all the more easy, for Hugh Lucy met her and told her, in one great burst of love, of his passionate attachment, his vehement struggles with his father, his impotence at present, his hopes and resolves for the future. And intermingled with all this came such outrageous threats and expressions of uncontrolled vehemence that Lois felt that in Barford she must not linger to be a cause of desperate quarrel between father and son, while her absence might soften down matters so that either the rich old miller might relent, or, and her heart ached to think of the other possibility, Hugh's love might cool, and the dear playfellow of her childhood might learn to forget. If not, if Hugh were to be trusted in one tithe of what he said, God might permit him to fulfil his resolve of coming to seek her out before many years were out. It was all in God's hands, and that was best, thought Lois Barclay. She was roused out of her trance of recollections by Captain Holderness, who, having done all that was necessary in the way of orders and directions to his mate, now came up to her, and praising her for her quiet patience, he told her that he would now take her to the Widow Smith's, a decent kind of house, where he and many other sailors of the better order were in the habit of lodging during their stay on the New England shores. Widow Smith, he said, had a parlour for herself and her daughters, in which Lois might sit, while he went about the business that he had before told her would detain him in Boston for a day or two, before he could accompany her to her uncle's at Salem. All this had been to a certain degree arranged on shipboard, but Captain Holderness, for want of anything else that he could think of to talk about, recapitulated it
as he and Lois walked along. It was his way of showing sympathy with the emotion that made her grey eyes full of tears as she started up from the pier at the sound of his voice. In his heart he said,
"Poor wench!
Poor wench! It is a strange land to her, and they are all strange folks, and I reckon she will be feeling desolate. I'll try and cheer her up." So he talked on about hard facts connected with the life that lay before her until they reached Widow Smith's. And perhaps Lois was more brightened by this style of conversation and the new ideas it presented to her than she would have been by the tenderest woman's sympathy.
"They're a queer set, these New Englanders," said Captain Holderness. "They are rare chaps for praying, down on their knees at every turn of their life. Folk are none so busy in a new country, else they would have to pray like me, with a yo-hoy on each side of my prayers, and a rope cutting like fire through my hand. Yon pilot was for calling us all to thanksgiving for a good voyage and lucky escape from the pirates. But, I said, I always put up my thanks on dry land, after I had got my ship into harbour. The French colonists, too, are vowing vengeance for the expedition against Canada, and the people here are raging like heathens, at least as like as godly folk can be, for the loss of their charter. All that is the news the pilot told me, for all he wanted us to be thanksgiving instead of casting the lead. He was as down in the mouth as could be about the state of the country. But here we are at Widow Smith's. Now cheer up and show the godly a pretty smiling Warwickshire lass." Anybody would have smiled at Widow Smith's greeting. She was a comely, motherly woman, dressed in the primmest fashion in vogue 20 years before in England, among the class to which she belonged. But somehow her pleasant face gave the lie to her dress. Were it as brown and sober-coloured as could be, folk remembered it bright and cheerful, because it was a part of Widow Smith herself. She kissed Lois on both cheeks, before she rightly understood who the stranger maiden was, only because she was a stranger and looked sad and forlorn. And then she kissed her again, because Captain Holderness commended her to the widow's good offices. And so she led Lois by the hand into her rough, substantial log-house, over the door of which hung a great bough of a tree, by way of sign of entertainment for man and horse. Yet not all men were received by Widow Smith. To some she could be as cold and reserved as need be, deaf to all inquiries save one. Where else could they find accommodation? To this question she would give a ready answer, and speed the unwelcome guest on his way. Widow Smith was guided in these matters by instinct. One glance at a man's face told her whether or not she chose to have him as an inmate of the same house as her daughters, and her promptness of decision in these matters gave her manner a kind of authority which no one liked to disobey, especially as she had stalwart neighbours within call to back her, if her assumed deafness in the first instance, and her voice and gesture in the second, were not enough to give the would-be guest his dismissal. Widow Smith chose her customers merely by their physical aspect, not one whit with regard to their apparent worldly circumstances. Those who had been staying at her house once always came again, for she had the knack of making everyone beneath her roof comfortable and at his ease. Her daughters, Prudence and Hester, had somewhat of their mother's gifts, but not in such perfection. They reasoned a little upon a stranger's appearance, instead of knowing at the first moment whether they liked him or no. They noticed the indications of his clothes, the quality and cut thereof, as telling somewhat of his station in society. They were more reserved. They hesitated more than their mother. They had not her prompt authority, her happy power. Their bread was not so light. Their cream went sometimes to sleep when it should have been turning into butter. Their hams were not always just like the hams of the old country, as their mothers were invariably pronounced to be. Yet they were good, orderly, kindly girls, and rose and greeted Lois with a friendly shake of the hand, as their mother, with her arm around the stranger's waist, led her into the private room which she called her parlour. The aspect of this room was strange in the English girl's eyes. The logs of which the house was built showed here and there through the mud plaster, although before both plaster and logs were hung the skins of many curious animals, skins presented to the widow by many a trader of her acquaintance, just as her sailor guests brought her another description of gift, shells, strings of wampum beads, seabirds' eggs, and presents from the old country. The room was more like a small museum of natural history of these days than a parlour, and it had a strange, peculiar, but not unpleasant smell about it, neutralised in some degree by the smoke from the enormous trunk of pine wood which smouldered on the hearth. The instant their mother told them that Captain Holderness was in the outer room, the girls began putting away their spinning wheel and knitting needles, and preparing for a meal of some kind. What meal, Lois, sitting there and unconsciously watching, could hardly tell. First, dough was set to rise for cakes. Then came out of a corner cupboard, a present from England, an enormous square bottle of a cordial called Golden Wasser. Next, a mill for grinding chocolate, a rare, unusual treat anywhere at that time. Then, a great Cheshire cheese. Three venison steaks were cut ready for broiling, fat cold pork sliced up and treacle poured over it, a great pie something like a mince pie, but which the daughters spoke of with honour as the punkin pie, fresh and salt fish branded, oysters cooked in various ways. Lois wondered where would be the end of the provisions for hospitably receiving the strangers from the old country. At length everything was placed on the table, the hot food smoking, but all was cool, not to say cold, before Elder Hawkins, an old neighbour of much repute and standing, who had been invited in by Widow Smith to hear the news, had finished his grace, into which was embodied thanksgivings for the past and prayers for the future lives of every individual present, adapted to their several cases, as far as the elder could guess at them from appearances. This grace might not have ended so soon as it did, had it not been for the somewhat impatient drumming of his knife-handle on the table, with which Captain Holderness accompanied the latter half of the elder's words. When they first sat down to their meal, all were too hungry for much talking, but as their appetites diminished, their curiosity increased, and there was much to be told and heard on both sides. With all the English intelligence, Lois was, of course, well acquainted, but she listened with natural attention to all that was said about the new country, the new people among whom she had come to live. Her father had been a Jacobite, as the adherents of the Stuarts were beginning at this time to be called. His father, again, had been a follower of Archbishop Laud. So Lois had hitherto heard little of the conversation and seen little of the ways of the Puritans. Elder Hawkins was one of the strictest of the strict, and evidently his presence kept the two daughters of the house considerably in awe. But the widow herself was a privileged person. Her known goodness of heart, the effects of which had been experienced by many, gave her the liberty of speech which was tacitly denied to many, under penalty of being esteemed ungodly if they infringed certain conventional limits. And Captain Holderness and his mate spoke out their minds, let who would be present, so that on this first landing in New England, Lois was, as it were, gently let down into the midst of the Puritan peculiarities, and yet they were sufficient to make her feel very lonely and strange. The first subject of conversation was the present state of the colony. Lois soon found out that, although at the beginning she was not a little perplexed by the frequent reference to names of places which she naturally associated with the old country. Widow Smith was speaking. In County of Essex, the folks are ordered to keep four scouts or companies of minutemen, six persons in each company, to be on the lookout for the wild Indians who are forever stirring about in the woods, stealthy brutes as they are. I'm sure I got such a fright the first harvest time after I came over to New England. I go on dreaming, now near 20 years after Lothrop's business, the painted Indians, with their shaven scalps and their war streaks, lurking behind the trees and coming nearer and nearer with their noiseless steps. Yes, broke in one of her daughters, and mother,
Don't you remember how Hannah Benson told us how her husband had cut down every tree near his house at Deerbrook, in order that no one might come near him under cover? And how one evening she was sitting in the twilight, when all her family were gone to bed, and her husband gone off to Plymouth on business, and she saw a log of wood, just like a trunk of a felled tree, lying in the shadow, and thought nothing of it, till, on looking again after a while after, she fancied it was come a bit nearer to the house, and how her heart turned sick with fright, and how she dared not stir at first, but looked again, and the shadow was deeper. But she could see that the log was nearer, so she ran in and bolted the door, and went up to where her eldest lad lay. It was Elijah, and he was but 16 then, but he rose up at his mother's words, and took his father's long duck-gun down, and he tried the loading, and spoke for the first time to put up a prayer that God would give his aim good guidance, and went to a window that gave upon the side where the log lay, and fired, and no one dared to look what came of it. But all the household read the scriptures, and prayed the whole night long till morning came, and showed a long stream of blood lying on the grass close by the log, which the full sunlight showed to be no log at all, but just a red Indian, covered with bark, and painted most skilfully, with his war knife by his side. All were breathless with listening, though to most the story, or such like it, were familiar. Then another took up the tale of horror.
"And the pirates have been down at Marblehead since you were here, Captain Holderness. 'Twas only the last winter they landed. French Papist pirates, and the people kept close within their houses, for they knew not what would come of it. And they dragged folk ashore. There was one woman among those folk, prisoners from some vessel, doubtless, and the pirates took them by force to the inland marsh. And the Marblehead folk kept still and quiet, every gun loaded, and every ear on the watch. But who knew but what the wild sea-robbers might take a turn on land next? And in the dead of the night, they heard a woman's loud and pitiful outcry from the marsh. "Lord Jesu, have mercy on me, save me from the power of man, O Lord Jesu!" And the blood of all who heard the cry ran cold with terror, till old Nance Hickson, who had been stone deaf and bedridden for years, stood up in the midst of the folk, all gathered together in her grandson's house, and said that as they, the dwellers in Marblehead, had not had brave hearts or faith enough to go and succour the helpless, that cry of a dying woman should be in their ears, and in their children's ears, till the end of the world. And Nance dropped down dead as soon as she had made an end of speaking, and the pirates set sail from Marblehead at morning dawn. But the folk there hear the cry still, shrill and pitiful from the waste marshes, "Lord Jesu, have mercy on me, save me from the power of man, O Lord Jesu!"
"And by token," said Elder Hawkins' deep bass voice, speaking with the strong nasal twang of the Puritans, who, says Butler, blasphemed custard through the nose, "godly Mr. Noyes ordained a fast at Marblehead, and preached a soul-stirring discourse on the words, 'Inasmuch as ye did it not unto the least of these little ones, ye did it not unto me.' But it has been borne in upon me at times, whether the whole vision of the pirates and the cry of the woman was not a device of Satan's to sift the Marblehead folk, and see what fruit their doctrine bore, and so to condemn them in the sight of the Lord. If it were so, the enemy had a great triumph, for assuredly it was no part of Christian men to leave a helpless woman unaided in her sore distress."
"But, Elder," said Widow Smith, "it was no vision. They were real living men who went ashore, men who broke down branches and left their footmarks on the ground."
"As for that matter, Satan hath many powers, and if it be the day when he is permitted to go about like a roaring lion, he will not stick at trifles, but make his work complete. I tell you, many men are spiritual enemies in visible forms, permitted to roam about the waste places of the earth. I myself believe that these Red Indians are indeed the evil creatures of whom we read in Holy Scripture, and there is no doubt that they are in league with those abominable Papists, the French people in Canada.
I have heard tell that the French pay the Indians so much gold for every dozen scalps off Englishmen's heads."
"Pretty cheerful talk, this," said Captain Holderness to Lois, perceiving her blanched cheek and terror-stricken mien. "Thou art thinking that thou hadst better have stayed at Barford." "I'll answer for it, wench. But the devil is not so black as he is painted."
"Oh, there again," said Elder Hawkins. "The devil is painted. It hath been said so from old times. And are not these Indians painted, even like unto their father?"
"But is it all true?" asked Lois, aside, of Captain Holderness, letting the elder hold forth unheeded by her, although listened to, however, with the utmost reverence by the two daughters of the house.
"My wench," said the old sailor, "thou hast come to a country where there are many perils, both from land and from sea. The Indians hate the white men, whether other white men, meaning the French away to the north, have hounded on the savages, or whether the English have taken their lands and hunting grounds without due recompense, and so raised the cruel vengeance of the wild creatures, who knows? But it is true that it is not safe to go far into the woods, for fear of the lurking painted savages. Nor has it been safe to build a dwelling far from a settlement. And it takes a brave heart to make a journey from one town to another, and folk do say the Indian creatures rise up out of the very ground to waylay the English. And then others affirm that they are all in league with Satan to affright the Christians out of the heathen country over which he has reigned so long. Then again, the seashore is infested by pirates, the scum of all nations. They land and plunder, and ravage and burn and destroy. Folk get affrighted of the real dangers, and in their fright imagine, perchance, dangers that are not. But who knows? Holy Scripture speaks of witches and wizards, and the power of the evil one in desert places. And even in the old country we have heard tell of those who have sold their souls for ever, for the little power they get for a few years on earth."
By this time the whole table was silent, listening to the captain. It was just one of those chance silences that sometimes occur without any apparent reason, and often without any apparent consequence. But all present had reason, before many months had passed over, to remember the words which Lois spoke in answer, although her voice was low, and she only thought, in the interest of the moment, of being heard by her old friend the captain. "They are fearful creatures, the witches. And yet I am sorry for the poor old women, whilst I dread them. We had one in Barford when I was a little child. No one knew when she came, but she settled herself down in a mud hut by the common side, and there she lived, she and her cat." At the mention of the cat, Elder Hawkins shook his head long and gloomily. "No one knew how she lived, if it were not on nettles and scraps of oatmeal and such like food, given her more for fear than for pity. She went double, always talking and muttering to herself. Folk said she snared birds and rabbits in the thicket that came down to her hovel. How it came to pass I cannot say, but many a one fell sick in the village, and much cattle died one spring when I was about 4 years old. I never heard much about it, for my father said it was ill talking about such things. I only know I got a sick fright one afternoon, when the maid had gone out for milk and taken me with her, and we were passing a meadow where the Avon, circling, makes a deep round pool, and there was a crowd of folk, all still, and a still, breathless crowd makes the heart beat worse than a shouting, noisy one. They were all gazing towards the water, and the maid held me up in her arms to see the sight above the shoulders of the people, and I saw old Hannah in the water, her grey hair all streaming down her shoulders, and her face bloody and black with the stones and the mud they had been throwing at her, and her cat tied round her neck. I hid my face, I know, as soon as I saw the fearsome sight, for her eyes met mine, as they were glaring with fury, poor, helpless, baited creature, and she caught the sight of me and cried out,
'Parson's wench, yonder, in thy nurse's arms! Thy dad hath never tried for to save me, and none shall save thee when thou art brought up for a witch.'
Oh, the words rang in my ears when I was dropping asleep. For years after,
I used to dream that I was in that pond, all men hating me with their eyes because I was a witch. And at times her black cat used to seem living again and say over those dreadful words. Lois stopped. The two daughters looked at her excitement with a kind of shrinking surprise, for the tears were in her eyes. Elder Hawkins shook his head and muttered texts from Scripture. But cheerful Widow Smith, not liking the gloomy turn of the conversation, tried to give it a lighter cast by saying, "And I don't doubt but what the parson's bonny lass has bewitched many a one since, with her dimples and her pleasant ways. Eh, Captain Holderness? It's you must tell us tales of this young lass's doings in England."
"Aye, aye," said the captain. "There's one under her charms in Warwickshire who will never get the better of it, I'm thinking."
Elder Hawkins rose to speak. He stood leaning on his hands, which were placed on the table.
"Brethren," said he, "I must upbraid you if ye speak lightly. Charms and witchcraft are evil things. I trust this maiden hath had nothing to do with them, even in thought. But my mind misgives me at her story. The hellish witch might have power from Satan to infect her mind, she being yet a child with the deadly sin. Instead of vain talking, I call upon you all to join with me in prayer for this stranger in our land, that her heart may be purged from all iniquity. Let us pray."
"Come, there's no harm in that," said the captain. "But, Elder Hawkins, when you're at work, just pray for us all, for I'm afeard there be some of us need purging from iniquity a good deal more than Lois Barclay, and a prayer for a man never does mischief."
Captain Holderness had business in Boston which detained him there for a couple of days, and during that time Lois remained with the Widow Smith, seeing what was to be seen of the new land that contained her future home. The letter of her dying mother was sent off to Salem, meanwhile, by a traveller going thither, in order to prepare her uncle, Ralph Hickson, for his niece's coming, as soon as Captain Holderness could find leisure to take her, for he considered her given into his own personal charge until he could consign her to her uncle's care. When the time came for going to Salem, Lois felt very sad at leaving the kindly woman under whose roof she had been staying, and looked back as long as she could see anything of Widow Smith's dwelling. She was packed into a rough kind of country cart, which just held her and Captain Holderness beside the driver. There was a basket of provisions under their feet, and behind them hung a bag of provender for the horse, for it was a good day's journey to Salem, and the road was reputed so dangerous that it was ill tarrying a minute longer than necessary for refreshment. English roads were bad enough at that period, and for long after, but in America the way was simply the cleared ground of the forest, the stumps of the felled trees still remaining in the direct line, forming obstacles which it required the most careful driving to avoid. And in the hollows, where the ground was swampy, the pulpy nature of it was obviated by logs of wood laid across the boggy part. The deep green forest, tangled into heavy darkness, even thus early in the year, came within a few yards of the road all the way, although efforts were regularly made by the inhabitants of the neighbouring settlements to keep a certain space clear on each side for fear of the lurking Indians, who might otherwise come upon them unawares. The cries of strange birds, the unwonted colour of some of them, all suggested to the imaginative or unaccustomed traveller the idea of war-whoops and painted deadly enemies. But at last they drew near to Salem, which rivalled Boston in size in those days, and boasted the name of one or two streets, although to an English eye they looked rather more like irregularly built houses clustered round the meeting-house, or rather one of the meeting-houses, for a second was in process of building. The whole place was surrounded with two circles of stockades. Between the two were the gardens and grazing-ground, for those who dreaded their cattle straying into the woods, and the consequent danger of reclaiming them. The lad who drove them flogged his spent horse into a trot as they went through Salem to Ralph Hickson's house. It was evening, the leisure time for the inhabitants, and their children were at play before the houses. Lois was struck by the beauty of one wee toddling child, and turned to look after it. It caught its little foot in a stump of wood, and fell with a cry that brought the mother out in a fright. As she ran out, her eye caught Lois's anxious gaze, although the noise of the heavy wheels drowned the sound of her words of inquiry as to the nature of the hurts the child had received. Nor had Lois time to think long upon the matter, for the instant after, the horse was pulled up at the door of a good, square, substantial wooden house, plastered over into a creamy white, perhaps as handsome a house as any in Salem. And there she was told by the driver that her uncle Ralph Hickson lived. In the flurry of the moment she did not notice, but Captain Holderness did, that no one came out at the unwonted sound of wheels to receive and welcome her. She was lifted down by the old sailor and led into a large room, almost like the hall of some English manor house as to size. A tall, gaunt young man, of 23 or 24, sat on a bench by one of the windows, reading a great folio by the fading light of day. He did not rise when they came in, but looked at them with surprise, no gleam of intelligence coming into his stern, dark face. There was no woman in the house-place. Captain Holderness paused a moment, and then said, "Is this house Ralph Hickson's?" "It is," said the young man, in a slow, deep voice. But he added no word further. "This is his niece, Lois Barclay," said the captain, taking the girl's arm and pushing her forwards. The young man looked at her steadily and gravely for a minute, then rose, and carefully marking the page in the folio, which hitherto had lain open upon his knee, said, still in the same heavy, indifferent manner, "I will call my mother. She will know." He opened a door which looked into a warm, bright kitchen, ruddy with the light of the fire, over which three women were apparently engaged in cooking something, while a fourth, an old Indian woman of a greenish-brown colour, shrivelled up and bent with apparent age, moved backwards and forwards, evidently fetching the others the articles they required. "Mother," said the young man, and having arrested her attention, he pointed over his shoulder to the newly arrived strangers, and returned to the study of his book, from time to time, however, furtively examining Lois from beneath his dark, shaggy eyebrows. A tall, largely made woman, past middle life, came in from the kitchen, and stood reconnoitring the strangers. Captain Holderness spoke. "This is Lois Barclay, Master Ralph Hickson's niece." "I know nothing of her," said the mistress of the house in a deep voice, almost as masculine as her son's. "Master Hickson received his sister's letter, did he not? I sent it off myself by a lad named Elias Wellbeloved, who left Boston for this place yestermorning." "Ralph Hickson has received no such letter. He lies bedridden in the chamber beyond. Any letters for him must come through my hands. Wherefore I can affirm with certainty that no such letter has been delivered here. His sister, Barclay, she that was Henrietta Hickson, and whose husband took the oaths to Charles Stuart and stuck by his living when all godly men left theirs." Lois, who had thought her heart was dead and cold a minute before at the ungracious reception she had met with, felt words come up into her mouth at the implied insult to her father, and spoke out to her own and the captain's astonishment. "They might be godly men who left their churches on that day of which you speak, madam, but they alone were not the godly men, and no one has a right to limit true godliness for mere opinion's sake." "Well said, lass," spoke out the captain, looking round upon her with a kind of admiring wonder, and patting her on the back. Lois and her aunt gazed into each other's eyes unflinchingly for a minute or two of silence, but the girl felt her colour coming and going, while the elder woman's never varied, and the eyes of the young maiden were filling fast with tears, while those of Grace Hickson kept on their stare, dry and unwavering. "Mother," said the young man, rising up with a quicker motion than anyone had yet used in this house, "it is ill speaking of such matters when my cousin comes first among us. The Lord may give her grace hereafter,
but he has travelled from Boston City today, and she and this seafaring man must need rest and food. He did not attend to see the effect of his words, but sat down again, and seemed to be absorbed in his book in an instant. Perhaps he knew that his word was law with his grim mother, for he had hardly ceased speaking before she had pointed to a wooden settle, and smoothing the lines on her countenance, she said, "What Manasseh says is true. Sit down here, while I bid Faith and Natty get food ready. And meanwhile I will go tell my husband that one who calls herself his sister's child is come over to pay him a visit." She went to the door leading into the kitchen, and gave some directions to the elder girl, whom Lois now knew to be the daughter of the house. Faith stood impassive, while her mother spoke, scarcely caring to look at the newly arrived strangers. She was like her brother Manasseh in complexion, but had handsomer features, and large mysterious-looking eyes, as Lois saw, when once she lifted them up, and took in, as it were, the aspect of the sea-captain and her cousin, with one swift searching look. About the stiff, tall, angular mother, and the scarce less pliant figure of the daughter, a girl of 12 years old or thereabouts, played all manner of impish antics, unheeded by them, as if it were her accustomed habit to peep about, now under their arms, now at this side, now at that, making grimaces all the while at Lois and Captain Holderness, who sat facing the door, weary and somewhat disheartened by their reception. The captain pulled out tobacco and began to chew it by way of consolation, but in a moment or two his usual elasticity of spirit came to his rescue, and he said in a low voice to Lois, "That scoundrel Elias, I will give it him. If the letter had but been delivered, thou wouldst have had a different kind of welcome. But as soon as I have had some victuals, I will go out and find the lad, and bring back the letter, and that will make all right, my wench. Nay, don't be downhearted, for I cannot stand women's tears. Thou art just worn out with the shaking and want of food." Lois brushed away her tears, and looking round to try and divert her thoughts by fixing them on present objects, she caught her cousin Manasseh's deep-set eyes, furtively watching her. It was with no unfriendly gaze, yet it made Lois uncomfortable, particularly as he did not withdraw his looks, after he must have seen that she observed him. She was glad when her aunt called her into an inner room to see her uncle, and she escaped from the steady observance of her gloomy, silent cousin. Ralph Hickson was much older than his wife, and his illness made him look older still. He had never had the force of character that Grace, his spouse, possessed, and age and indisposition had now rendered him almost childish at times. But his nature was affectionate, and stretching out his trembling arms from where he lay bedridden, he gave Lois an unhesitating welcome, never waiting for the confirmation of the missing letter before he acknowledged her to be his niece.
"Oh, 'tis kind in thee to come all across the sea, to make acquaintance with thine uncle. Kind in Sister Barclay to spare thee."
Lois had to tell him that there was no one living to miss her at home in England, that in fact she had no home in England, no father nor mother left upon the earth, and that she had been bidden by her mother's last words to seek him out and ask him for a home. Her words came up, half choked from a heavy heart, and his dulled wits could not take their meaning in without several repetitions. And then he cried like a child, rather at his own loss of a sister, whom he had not seen for more than 20 years, than at that of the orphans standing before him, trying hard not to cry, but to start bravely in this new strange home. What most of all helped Lois in her self-restraint was her aunt's unsympathetic look. Born and bred in New England, Grace Hickson had a kind of jealous dislike to her husband's English relations, which had increased, since of late years his weakened mind yearned after them, and he forgot the good reason he had for his self-exile, and moaned over the decision which had led to it as the great mistake of his life. "Come," said she, it strikes me that in all this sorrow for the loss of one who died full of years, ye are forgetting in whose hands life and death are. True words, but ill-spoken at that time. Lois looked up at her with a scarcely disguised indignation, which increased as she heard the contemptuous tone in which her aunt went on talking to Elias Hickson, even while she was arranging his bed with a regard to his greater comfort. "One would think thou wert a godless man, by the moan thou art always making over spilt milk, and truth is, thou art but childish in thine old age. When we were wed, thou left all things to the Lord. I would never have married thee else." "Nay, lass," said she, catching the expression on Lois's face, "thou art never going to browbeat me with thine angry looks. I do my duty as I read it, and there is never a man in Salem that dare speak a word to Grace Hickson about either her works or her faith. Godly Mr. Cotton, mother, hath said that even he might learn of me, and I would advise thee rather to humble thyself and see if the Lord may not convert thee from thy ways, since he has sent thee to dwell, as it were, in Zion, where the precious dew falls daily on Aaron's beard."
Lois felt ashamed and sorry to find that her aunt had so truly interpreted the momentary expression of her features. She blamed herself a little for the feeling that had caused that expression, trying to think how much her aunt might have been troubled with something before the unexpected eruption of the strangers, and again hoping that the remembrance of this little misunderstanding would soon pass away. So she endeavoured to reassure herself, and not to give way at her uncle's tender, trembling pressure of her hand, as, at her aunt's bidding, she wished him good night and returned into the outer, or keeping room, where all the family were now assembled, ready for the meal of flour cakes and venison steaks, which Natty, the Indian servant, was bringing in from the kitchen. No one seemed to have been speaking to Captain Holderness while Lois had been away. Manasseh sat quiet and silent where he did, with the book open upon his knee, his eyes thoughtfully fixed on vacancy, as or dreamed dreams. Faith stood by the table, lazily directing Natty in her preparations, and Prudence lolled against the doorframe, between kitchen and keeping room, playing tricks on the old Indian woman as she passed backwards and forwards, till Natty appeared to be in a strong state of expressed irritation, which she tried in vain to repress, as whenever she showed any sign of it, Prudence only seemed excited to greater mischief. When all was ready, Manasseh lifted his right hand and asked a blessing, as it was termed. But the grace became a long prayer for abstract spiritual blessings, for strength to combat Satan and to quench his fiery darts, and at length assumed, so Lois thought, a purely personal character, as if the young man had forgotten the occasion, and even the people present, but was searching into the nature of the diseases that beset his own sick soul, and spreading them out before the Lord. He was brought back by a pluck at the coat from Prudence. He opened his shut eyes, cast an angry glance at the child, who made a face at him for all reply, and then he sat down, and they all fell to. Grace Hickson would have thought her hospitality sadly at fault if she had allowed Captain Holderness to go out in search of a bed. Skins were spread for him on the floor of the keeping room. A Bible and a square bottle of spirits were placed on the table to supply his wants during the night. And in spite of all the cares and troubles, temptations or sins of the members of that household, they were all asleep before the town clock struck 10. In the morning, the captain's first care was to go out in search of the boy Elias and the missing letter. He met the boy bringing it with an easy conscience, for, thought Elias, a few hours sooner or later will make no difference. Tonight or the morrow morning will be all the same. But he was startled into a sense of wrongdoing by a sound box on the ears from the very man who had charged him to deliver it speedily, and whom he believed to be at that very moment in Boston City. The letter delivered, or possible proof being given that Lois had a right to claim a home from her nearest relations, Captain Holderness thought it best to take leave.
thou'lt take to them, lass, maybe, when there is no one here to make thee think on the old country. Nay, nay, parting is hard work at all times, and best gets hard work done out of hand. Keep up thine heart, my wench, and I'll come back and see thee next spring, if we are all spared till then, and who knows what fine young miller mayn't come with me. Don't go and get wed to a praying Puritan, meanwhile. There, there, I'm off. God bless thee. And Lois was left alone in New England. End of part the first.
Part the second of Lois the Witch by Elizabeth Gaskell. It was hard uphill work for Lois to win herself a place in this family. Her aunt was a woman of narrow, strong affections. Her love for her husband, if ever she had had any, was burnt out and dead long ago. What she did for him, she did from duty, but duty was not strong enough to restrain that little member, the tongue, and Lois's heart often bled at the continual flow of contemptuous reproof which Grace constantly addressed to her husband, even while she was sparing no pains or trouble to minister to his bodily ease and comfort. It was more as a relief to herself that she spoke in this way than with any desire that her speeches should affect him, and he was too deadened by illness to feel hurt by them, or, it may be, the constant repetition of her sarcasms had made him indifferent. At any rate, so that he had his food and his state of bodily warmth attended to, he very seldom seemed to care much for anything else. Even his first flow of affection towards Lois was soon exhausted. He cared for her because she arranged his pillows well and skilfully, and because she could prepare new and dainty kinds of food for his sick appetite, but no longer for her as his dead sister's child. Still, he did care for her, and Lois was too glad of this little hoard of affection to examine how or why it was given. To him she could give pleasure, but apparently to no one else in that household. Her aunt looked askance at her for many reasons. The first coming of Lois to Salem was inopportune. The expression of disapprobation on her face on that evening still lingered and rankled in Grace's memory. Early prejudices and feelings and prepossessions of the English girl were all on the side of what would now be called church and state, what was then esteemed in that country a superstitious observance of the directions of a papish rubric and a servile regard for the family of an oppressing and irreligious king. Nor is it to be supposed that Lois did not feel, and feel acutely, the want of sympathy that all those with whom she was now living manifested towards the old hereditary loyalty, religious as well as political loyalty, in which she had been brought up. With her aunt and Manasseh, it was more than want of sympathy. It was positive, active antipathy to all the ideas Lois held most dear. The very allusion, however incidentally made, to the little old grey church at Barford, where her father had preached so long, the occasional reference to the troubles in which her own country had been distracted when she left, and the adherence in which she had been brought up to the notion that the king could do no wrong, seemed to irritate Manasseh past endurance. He would get up from his reading, his constant employment when at home, and walk angrily about the room after Lois had said anything of this kind, muttering to himself, and once he had even stopped before her, and in a passionate tone bade her not talk so like a fool. Now all this was very different to his mother's sarcastic, contemptuous way of treating all poor Lois's little loyal speeches. Grace would lead her on, at least she did at first, till experience made Lois wiser, to express her thoughts on such subjects, till just when the girl's heart was opening, her aunt would turn round upon her with some bitter sneer that roused all the evil feelings in Lois's disposition by its sting. Now Manasseh seemed, through all his anger, to be so really grieved by what he considered her error, that he went much nearer to convincing her that there might be two sides to a question. Only this was a view that it was like treachery to her dead father's memory to entertain. Somehow Lois felt instinctively
that Manasseh was really friendly towards her. He was little in the house. There was farming and some kind of mercantile business to be transacted by him, as real head of the house. And as the season drew on, he went shooting and hunting in the surrounding forests, with a daring which caused his mother to warn and reprove him in private, although to the neighbours she boasted largely of her son's courage and disregard of danger. Lois did not often walk out for the mere sake of walking. There was generally some household errand to be transacted when any of the women of the family went out. But once or twice she had caught glimpses of the dreary dark wood hemming in the clear land on all sides, the great wood with its perpetual movement of branch and bough, and its solemn wail that came into the very streets of Salem when certain winds blew, bearing the sound of the pine trees clear upon the ears that had leisure to listen. And from all accounts, this old forest, girdling round the settlement, was full of dreaded and mysterious beasts, and still more to be dreaded Indians, stealing in and out among the shadows, intent on bloody schemes against the Christian people. Panther-streaked, shaven Indians, in league by their own confession, as well as by the popular belief, with evil powers. Natty, the old Indian servant, would occasionally make Lois's blood run cold, as she and Faith and Prudence listened to the wild stories she told them of the wizards of her race. It was often in the kitchen, in the darkening evening, while some cooking process was going on, that the old Indian crone, sitting on her haunches by the bright redwood embers which sent up no flame, but a lurid light reversing the shadows of all the faces around, told her weird stories while they were awaiting the rising of the dough, perchance out of which the household bread had to be made. There ran through them always a ghastly, unexpressed suggestion of some human sacrifice being needed to complete the success of any incantation to the evil one. And the poor old creature, herself believing and shuddering as she narrated her tale in broken English, took a strange, unconscious pleasure in her power over her hearers, young girls of the oppressing race, which had brought her down into a state little differing from slavery, and reduced her people to outcasts on the hunting grounds which had belonged to her ancestors. After such tales, it required no small effort on Lois's part to go out at her aunt's command into the common pasture round the town and bring the cattle home at night. Who knew but what the double-headed snake might start up from each blackberry bush, that wicked, cunning, accursed creature in the service of the Indian wizards that had such power over all those white maidens who met the eyes placed at either end of his long, sinuous, creeping body, so that loathe him, loathe the Indian race as they would, off they must go into the forest to seek out some Indian man, and must beg to be taken into his wigwam, abjuring faith and race for ever. Or there were spells, so Natty said, hidden about the ground by the wizards, which changed that person's nature who found them, that, gentle and loving as they might have been before, thereafter they took no pleasure but in the cruel torments of others, and had a strange power given to them of causing such torments at their will. Once Natty, speaking low to Lois, who was alone with her in the kitchen, whispered out her terrified belief that such a spell had Prudence found, and when the Indian showed her arms to Lois, all pinched black and blue by the impish child, the English girl began to be afraid of her cousin as of one possessed. But it was not Natty alone, nor young imaginative girls alone, that believed in these stories. We can afford to smile at them now, but our English ancestors
entertained superstitions
of much the same character at the same period, and with less excuse, as the circumstances surrounding them were better known, and consequently more explicable by common sense, than the real mysteries of the deep untrodden forests of New England. The gravest divines not only believed stories similar to that of the double-headed serpent and other tales of witchcraft, but they made such narrations the subjects of preaching and prayer. And as cowardice makes us all cruel, men who were blameless in many of their relations of life and even praiseworthy in some, became, from superstition, cruel persecutors about this time, showing no mercy towards anyone whom they believed to be in league with the evil one. Faith was the person with whom the English girl was the most intimately associated in her uncle's house. The two were about the same age, and certain household employments were shared between them. They took it in turns to call in the cows, to make up the butter which had been churned by Hosea, a stiff old outdoor servant, in whom Grace Hickson placed great confidence. And each lassie had her great spinning wheel for wool and her lesser for flax. Before a month had elapsed after Lois's coming, Faith was a grave, silent person, never merry, sometimes very sad, though Lois was a long time in even guessing why. She would try in her sweet, simple fashion to cheer her cousin up when the latter was depressed by telling her old stories of English ways and life. Occasionally, Faith seemed to care to listen. Occasionally, she did not heed one word, but dreamed on. Whether of the past or the future, who could tell? Stern old ministers came in to pay their pastoral visits. On such occasions, Grace Hickson would put on a clean apron and clean cap, and make them more welcome than she was ever seen to do anyone else, bringing out the best provisions of her store, and setting of all before them. Also the great Bible was brought forth, and Hosea and Natty, summoned from their work to listen, while the minister read a chapter, and as he read, expounded it at considerable length. After this, all knelt, while he, standing, lifted up his right hand, and prayed for all possible combinations of Christian men, for all possible cases of spiritual need, and lastly, taking the individuals before him, a very personal supplication for each, according to his notion of their wants. At first Lois wondered at the aptitude of one or two of his prayers of this description to the outward circumstances of each case, but when she perceived that her aunt had usually a pretty long confidential conversation with the minister in the early part of his visit, she became aware that he received both his impressions and his knowledge through the medium of that godly woman, Grace Hickson. And I am afraid she paid less regard to the prayer for the maiden from another land, who hath brought the errors of that land as a seed with her, even across the great ocean, and who is letting even now the little seed shoot up into an evil tree, in which all unclean creatures may find shelter.
"I like the prayers of our church better," said Lois one day to Faith. "No clergyman in England can pray his own words, and therefore it is that he cannot judge of others so as to fit his prayers to what he esteems to be their case, as Mr. Tappow did this morning."
"I hate Mr. Tappow," said Faith shortly,
a passionate flash of light coming out of her dark, heavy eyes.
"Why so, cousin? It seems to me as if he were a good man, although I like not his prayers."
Faith only repeated her words,
"I hate him."
Lois was sorry for this strong, bad feeling. Instinctively sorry, for she was loving herself, delighted in being loved, and felt a jar run through her at every sign of want of love in others. But she did not know what to say, and was silent at the time. Faith, too, went on turning her wheel with vehemence, but spoke never a word until her thread snapped, and then she pushed the wheel away hastily and left the room. Then Prudence crept softly up to Lois's side. This strange child seemed to be tossed about by varying moods. Today she was caressing and communicative. Tomorrow she might be deceitful, mocking, and so indifferent to the pain or sorrows of others that you could call her almost indignant.
"So, thou dost not like Pastor Tappan's prayers?" she whispered.
Lois was sorry to have been overheard, but she neither would nor could take back her words.
"I like them not so well as the prayers I used to hear at home."
"Mother says thy home was with the ungodly."
"Nay, don't look at me so. It was not I that said it. I'm none so fond of praying myself, nor of Pastor Tappow, for that matter. But Faith cannot abide him, and I know why. Shall I tell thee, cousin Lois?" No, Faith did not tell me, and she was the right person to give her own reasons. Ask her where young Mr. Nolan is gone to, and thou wilt hear. I have seen Faith cry by the hour together about Mr. Nolan. Hush, child, hush, said Lois, for she heard Faith's approaching step, and feared lest she should overhear what they were saying. The truth was that a year or two before there had been a great struggle in Salem village, a great division in the religious body, and Pastor Tappan had been the leader of the more violent and ultimately the successful party. In consequence of this, the less popular minister, Mr. Nolan, had had to leave the place, and him Faith Hickson loved with all the strength of her passionate heart, although he never was aware of the attachment he had excited, and her own family were too regardless of manifestations of mere feeling to ever observe the signs of any emotion on Faith's part. But the old Indian servant, Natty, saw and observed them all. She knew, as well as if she had been told the reason, why Faith had lost all care about father or mother, brother and sister, about household work and daily occupation, nay, about the observances of religion as well. Natty read the meaning of the deep smouldering of Faith's dislike to Pastor Tappan aright. The Indian woman understood why the girl, whom alone of all the white people she loved, avoided the old minister, would hide in the woodstack sooner than be called in to listen to his exhortations and prayers. With savage, untutored people, it is not, love me, love my dog. They are often jealous of the creature beloved, but it is, whom thou hatest, I will hate, and Natty's feeling towards Pastor Tappan was even an exaggeration of the mute, unspoken hatred of Faith. For a long time, the cause of her cousin's dislike and avoidance of the minister was a mystery to Lois, but the name of Nolan remained in her memory, whether she would or no, and it was more from girlish interest in the suspected love affair than from any indifferent and heartless curiosity that she could not help piecing together little speeches and actions with Faith's interest in the absent, banished minister for an explanatory cue, till not a doubt remained in her mind. And this, without any further communication with Prudence, for Lois declined hearing any more on the subject from her, and so gave deep offence. Faith grew sadder and duller as the autumn drew on. She lost her appetite. Her brown complexion became sallow and colourless. Her dark eyes looked hollow and wild. The 1st of November was near at hand. Lois, in her instinctive, well-intentioned efforts to bring some life and cheerfulness into the monotonous household, had been telling Faith of many English customs. Silly enough, no doubt, and which scarcely lighted up a flicker of interest in the American girl's mind. The cousins were lying awake in their bed in the great unplastered room, which was in part storeroom, in part bedroom. Lois was full of sympathy for Faith that night. For long she had listened to her cousin's heavy, irrepressible sighs in silence. Faith sighed because her grief was of too old a date for violent emotion or crying. Lois listened without speaking in the dark, quiet night hours for a long, long time. She kept quite still because she thought such vents for sorrow might relieve her cousin's weary heart. But when at length, instead of lying motionless, Faith seemed to be growing restless, even to convulsive motions of her limbs, Lois began to speak, to talk about England and the dear old ways at home, without exciting much attention on Faith's part, until at length she fell upon the subject of Halloween, and told about customs then and long afterwards practised in England, and scarcely yet died out in Scotland. As she told of tricks she had often played, of the apple eaten facing a mirror, the dripping sheet, of the basins of water, of the nuts burning side by side, and many other such innocent ways of divination, by which laughing, trembling English maidens sought to see the form of their future husbands, if husbands they were to have. Then Faith listened breathlessly, asking short, eager questions, as if some ray of hope had entered into her gloomy heart. Lois went on speaking,
telling her of all the stories that would confirm the truth of the second sight vouchsafed to all seekers in the accustomed methods, half believing, half incredulous herself, but desiring, above all things, to cheer up poor Faith. Suddenly Prudence rose up from her truckle bed in the dim corner of the room. They had not thought that she was awake, but she had been listening long.
"Cousin Lois may go out and meet Satan by the brookside if she will, but if thou goest, Faith, I will tell my mother, aye, and I will tell past the tappan too. Hold thy stories, Cousin Lois. I'm afeard of my very life. I would rather never be wed at all than feel the touch of the creature that would take the apple out of my hand as I held it over my left shoulder."
The excited girl gave a loud scream of terror at the image her fancy had conjured up. Faith and Lois sprang out towards her, flying across the moonlit room in their white nightgowns. At the same instant, summoned by the same cry, Grace Hickson came to her child.
"Hush, hush," said Faith authoritatively.
"What is it, my wench?" asked Grace, while Lois, feeling as if she had done all the mischief, kept silence.
"Take her away, take her away," screamed Prudence. "Look over her shoulder, her left shoulder. The evil one is there now. I see him stretching over for the half-bitten apple."
"What is this she says?" said Grace austerely.
"She's dreaming," said Faith. "Prudence, hold thy tongue."
And she pinched the child severely, while Lois, more tenderly, tried to soothe the alarm she felt that she had conjured up.
"Be quiet, Prudence," said she, "and go to sleep. I will stay by thee till thou hast gone off into slumber." "No, no, go away," sobbed Prudence,
who was really terrified at first, but was now assuming more alarm than she felt from the pleasure she received at perceiving herself the centre of attention.
"Faith shall stay by me, not you, wicked English witch."
So Faith sat by her sister, and Grace, displeased and perplexed, withdrew to her own bed, purposing to inquire more into the matter in the morning. Lois only hoped it might all be forgotten by morning, and resolved never to talk again of such things. But an event happened in the remaining hours of the night to change the current of affairs. While Grace had been absent from her room, her husband had had another paralytic stroke. Whether he too had been alarmed by that eldritch scream, no one could ever know. By the faint light of the rush candle burning at the bedside, his wife perceived that a great change had taken place in his aspect on her return. The irregular breathing came almost like snorts. The end was drawing near. The family were roused, and all help given that either the doctor or experience could suggest. But before the late November morning light, all was ended for Ralph Hickson. The whole of the ensuing day, they sat or moved in darkened rooms, and spoke few words, and those below their breath. Manasseh kept at home, regretting his father, no doubt, but showing but little emotion. Faith was the child that bewailed her loss most grievously. She had a warm heart, hidden away somewhere under her moody exterior, and her father had shown her far more passive kindness than ever her mother had done, for Grace made distinct favourites of Manasseh, her only son, and Prudence, her youngest child. Lois was about as unhappy as any of them, for she had felt strongly drawn towards her uncle as her kindest friend, and the sense of his loss renewed the old sorrow she had experienced at her own parents' death. But she had no time and no place to cry in. On her devolved many of the cares which it would have seemed indecorous in the nearer relations to interest themselves in enough to take an active part. The change required in their dress, the household preparations for the sad feast of the funeral, Lois had to arrange all under her aunt's stern direction. But a day or two afterwards, the last day before the funeral, she went into the yard to fetch in some faggots for the oven. It was a solemn, beautiful, starlit evening, and some sudden sense of desolation in the midst of the vast universe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.